Let me take a moment to introduce Sandra Lockhart and Sandra, who has taken a strong interest throughout her career in the issues surrounding health care with First Nations. And she served for several years on the Canada Northwest FASD Research Network and participated in the Governor General's Aboriginal Health Forum. She's the founding chair of the Institute for, for Circumpolar Health Research and has been an executive member of the NWT Native Women's Association. She's been elected to the North region as the alternate regional executive vice president for the Public Service Alliance of Canada, the founding chair for the PSAC North NWT Aboriginal People's Committee, and elected as the North female representative of the National PSAC Aboriginal People's Circle. And recently has become the National PSAC Aboriginal Human Rights Committee representative. So you can see that Sandra has taken a very active career interest in her life in dealing with these types of issues. And so Sandra, please.
I'm really comfortable standing, so I'm not comfortable sitting down, and I'm not good, and I have a sister here who knows that I'm not good at keeping notes and writing speeches, so I'm going to ask you to bear with me. The elders have always said to me, you know, there's a medicine for everything, and there's one medicine that it's in your interest and in the interest of people such as yourselves who've given me your greatest gift that's yours to give away, and that's your time. And as I get older, I start to really understand what that means. And that medicine, they say, is prayer. And it can be whatever it is for you and for me and for us collectively and even internationally. So my heart is pounding right now and I need to settle down. And so I'm going to ask you, if you will, and if you don't, that's fine, because we have democracy in this room, if you join me in prayer, because I need that medicine right now that I share. Because the elders always say, you be the first person to hear what comes out of your mouth, especially when you pray, because Creator's going to talk through you, and don't walk around and wonder around like you came up with it. So I'd ask if you would, for just a brief moment, just stand with me in prayer. I'm just going to say a couple of words in my own language. Numa wavaska, piasosko, okama, piaso, iniskumten, gamino aski, iniskumten. Creator, I just thank you for the gift of life, and I want to thank you for all the abundance that I see and all that I don't see. And I ask for you to be kind with me and to give me words that I only not hear, but that speak to the people who are not speaking today, and raise us up in your strength. I ask this in your name, all my relations of hope.
Blessing.
It always helps, and it gets me back in the right place, because when you get a big thing read about you like that, it's kind of... But I forget, it's taken time, and you never do anything on your own, and that's what I love about panels and things like that, is anything great is always done in the spirit of solidarity. I would just like to clarify that I'm not here representing PSAC, although I am a proud member of the Public Service Alliance of Canada. I'm representing, very much like yourselves, I'm a citizen of Canada. And I, very much like you, are very interested in my health care. And I've been very privileged and honored, and sometimes I wonder, heavily burdened with all of the knowledge. So I'm hoping that I do justice with your time today. And I was asked, I said, when I speak, I'd like to talk about cultural competence and healthcare. And I want to frame that right now. Because healthcare has had a culture. I was born into that culture, as you were. And the understanding that I had of healthcare, because healthcare service and service delivery has thoughts, it has its own language, it has its own traditions and its own behavior. It's a living thing and is delivered by people like me and you. And the message that it had put out to public is we have a very complex system where we manage resources for healing. Now, just that statement by itself, everybody's flag should have went off, much like Dennis, where we were in phase one for how long and where Ross was problems, because we're working towards the healing. But if you're in economics, that's phenomenal, because then you start creating other businesses. You start negotiating with other people for pharmacy. You start establishing institutions for healthcare. You start establishing offices for governing. And you may need one part of that healthcare system, but you're going to have to be navigated all the way through it to get what you need, if it's applicable to you and you fit the criteria, right? So that's where the competence comes into play, is how much knowledge do we have that we know how to navigate through that? And every time I thought of that, I kept thinking of the Occupy movement. There's only 1% that knows how to do that. There's only 1% that knows how to, that thing works, that machine works. And it is a big, complex machine. But it's not set up for me and you in the way it could be. Now, it hasn't been working. So the culture of healthcare has shifted, with or without our awareness. And if you pay attention to the ads, they'll talk about patient-centered care. And it sort of gets in your mind, oh, they've individualized it to my needs. That's not what it's saying. Don't go there. What it means is we now have a culture called self-management. Okay? So with self-management, they're very aware they need to do a lot more on education and how you manage your health care. But we're still caught in a funny place because we still have these little departments that everything fits into. And we'll say, the environment is over here, the economy is over here, health is over here, education is over here. And I know this because I've had several interactions on different things, and they'd say, well, you can only talk to my department about this because I don't have anything to do with that. But I go, how could you say that? Because what you do over there impacts what we do over here. So we're still trying to work in a system that we're fooling ourselves that it's not interrelated. So I want to say a name today, and God bless her if she's rolling around in spirit world. But there's a woman by the name of Lawrence Bird who played an incredible role in me standing here today. When she was born, in my people's view of the world, they saw her coming through ceremony, and they knew exactly why she was coming. And her whole youth was in healthcare because they knew she was going to be a provider. So from the time she was small, she would go to all these ceremonies to learn how to do that and way of thinking. And she knew who the big boss was. It was the creator. This woman I'm talking about is my grandmother. And English, she called it a medicine woman. And her, she knew that she had nothing to do. It was the medicines. It was the spirit in which the creator put into the medicines. And it was her knowledge. She was a knowledge keeper. That's how we say it in my language. We're knowledge keepers. Each one of us, we're knowledge keepers. We're bearers of culture, and we need to be confident that. But what she's seen over time was the breakaway from the medicine of prayer and the breakaway from the spirituality. And spirituality is what binds us all together. We see that in the social movements like Idle No More. Idle No More is talking about what our people need in our democracy. The students are talking about, we have a right to this, we have a right to education, why are you taking that away from us? So there's a spirit and the truth in all of these social movements. And we need to get back to that if we want what we call sound health. That's the only way we're going to get health. Because when we talk about self-management, which means they imply that we're responsible for our health, and they forget, if we're not having a government that is serious about the environment and the effect the environment has on us with climate change, and we know our government at this time has stopped all the research on climate change. Scientists are having to leave our country to get a job, right? If we look at economics, how is people's health when you're worried about your job because they're shutting jobs down? I'm scared if I can't pay my rent. I've got four kids that I have to pay for. I pay taxes just like you. That's what I love about the North, is Aboriginal people pay taxes here. We're paying for our own treaty, for crying out loud, right? So, but we don't get the same services in the communities. So there's a bunch of things that people don't understand. The resources. Our country's getting sold out to another country, so what have we got to negotiate with the international trade agreements? Different countries are saying, well, I'll be the one that'll produce all the bulk generics you buy. United States will say, I'll supply it to Canada. We'll make that deal at the top. So the federal government is very much involved with healthcare, but it's way up here. And it's multinational corporations, and we tend to talk about them like they're not people. There are people up there that are running those, and it's a mindset, and it's a culture. My kids know more about Nike than they know about the East Arc, because healthcare influences the culture that we live. And if we're not mindful of it, and if we think that corporations and federal governments and the premiers or the prime ministers and all those government leaders are up there, these corporations don't know what Canada is. They just know it's a place they get off the plane and make the negotiations and off they go. And Canada thinks, oh, you know, our culture is changing so much. It's being decided at the top, and they don't have a sense of country. They have a sense of business. And there's a sickness in there because the spirit is missing. That we tend to forget we are dependent on the resources in a way that if we don't take care of the land, because that's where everything comes from, it's in this, it's in this, it's in our food, we depend on those resources to survive. And if we don't get sustainable, it needs, that environment needs to take care of itself. And we're not raised to think that it's alive and it has a purpose and it will heal itself. We don't think that way. And we better wake up, because it is going to change. And what we have a responsibility, I think, at this point that we have any control over right now, is to educate ourselves. Because the resources out there that the government's going to allow us to have is going to be very limited. If you look at free trade agreements, those agreements are actually cutting into what we're allowed to have on internet and what we're not. And they'll just cut us right off if they don't like it. So our democracy is being eroded as we sit in this room, and we're the ones who have to stand up and say, my health begins with my right to think the way I want to think. And it begins with the type of life and the vision that I have with life. And if I don't exercise that democratic right, then they're going to do it for us. And that's what I love about all of the health care that I see right now in the social movements. That is what I call cultural competence in health care. Because that's how far down the line we have gotten. And you have to know, if anybody knows me, I never used to vote. I used to be, no, you know, it's not my government, it's not this, and I was just whatever. And now I'm the vice president of our Arctic constituency office here. And why do I do that? I do that because I have a responsibility to you, but more importantly, I have 10 grandchildren. What the heck am I leaving them? I'm responsible for what I leave them to work with, to make a life for themselves. And I have committed myself, especially for the last 3 years, educating them. Because what I want as their greatest identity is their democracy. And there's all kinds of issues around that. And me and you, and I'm not assuming that you're NDP because you're sitting in here. Because I'll tell you how this power play works, is when it comes election time, healthcare will be the biggest agenda. It is every election, okay? Because that's the most important thing. Everything else has to come after that. Any kind of development, any kind of partnerships. Because if we cannot feed ourselves, we cannot live. And we have got mental health, we've got chronic diseases. Yes, we're living longer, but we're living longer with chronic diseases that we can't afford to take care of. And the genetics of the environment affects our genetics. So the children that are getting produced don't have the same capacities because they're getting affected by what we do to the environment. And the chemicals we put in our bodies is affecting them. So we have a responsibility. And I'm hoping that you realize that globalization in itself was going to happen. There's prophecies, whether it's scriptural, whether it's with my people, whether it's any other culture. Globalization has been prophesized. What we have an incredible burden to bear is that privatization is happening in Canada. We just don't notice it because the government through Medicare. But who do you think they're paying? They're paying private companies. And as they cut back, what's going to increase is the visibility of these private industries. And private industries like profit. And when they get profit, they start infecting with unions, because they're attacking unions left, right, and center. Because we need a certain salary to live by and a certain type of comfort. So we fight for it, we work for it, we want our democracy. And anything that's fighting for democracy is getting shut down. Now, I joined this particular party, and I say it, and I've said it to Dennis, and I'll say it worldwide, is you've never had a shot to bugger us up. I want to be there, okay? And I want to show that as governments, we can do it, because the people have forgotten that the government belongs to the people. It's not Harper's government. This is our government. Governments, whether they're international or not, belong to the people because we suffer the results. Just like when you parent, you make decisions, the kids live with those decisions. It's no different here. So we have to know there's urbanization going on. How many of you want to move to Inuvik? Because there's no clinic up there. How many in this room even know that or care? Right? They have to go, we haven't got the right clinics. How many of you want to move to a community where there's no services, next to none? Very few. Because I'll tell you, a lot of us don't want to work there either. So you get torn and you get pushed around, and that's how we get controlled. And it's hard. It's really hard when you're trying to take care of yourself and your family. But it's all strategic plays. So that is happening. And my people will say they starved us, they put us on reserves to starve, now they're starving us off. In high level, there's going to be a meeting, because Medivac is getting taken away from them. The biggest population there, 7 reserves, who's going to notice? So we have to stop and think about when this type of fear-mongering happens, it's in within our natural natures to get very selfish and very self-centered, and I'm just as guilty as everyone else. And so the challenge is to use the medicine the elders said, please pray, because you're going to want to buckle under, to get along, to get the benefits. And I've been under that gun many times, and it's been a tough call lately. The other thing that's happening is they're looking at population health. But what population is going to face, or subpopulation is going to face, so this population benefits? are we actually going to start looking at what Canada has always been famous for, is the quality and the sharing. People love that about Canadians. But that's never been the history of my people. And what did work for us was outlawed. And today, you know, government wants to do things like with naturopath. Those things work. Why isn't it put on the agenda to work for us? Why aren't we having access to it if we're that concerned about Canadians' health? So there's much more that I suppose I should have said and could have said. But I think the biggest thing that I've learned when it comes to healthcare and cultural competency is healthcare has a language. I better learn what it is. I better be competent at knowing politically what's going on, not only locally, regionally, and nationally within Canada, because the real game shaking and game playing is international. And I better understand who's benefiting it and what it's costing us. Because not only is the cost rising for healthcare, we're losing our negotiating power because of our resources. When you looked at that aging population, well, there goes the workers. We don't have, I've always loved the statistic with thing when they say, you know, Canadians have 1.5 kids. I go, how do they have half a kid? I can't do that. We're not replacing the aging population. So people are getting really upset across Canada because they're saying, oh, all those immigrants are coming in and taking over our jobs. But do they realize those immigrants pay $30,000 to come here? And then don't get what they're supposed to anyway. Work for 4 or 5 months. We live off the benefits of what they've contributed to their wages and stuff, and then we send them home and they can't come back here. And they're usually going to worse conditions than we are because we've been over there and dug everything up, took all their resources, and they have to try to come here to feed their families back home because we won't let them bring their families here anymore. So if that's not the height of selfishness, what is it? And now we're going to do it to ourselves. And you know what? We're stepping back and we're letting people do it to us. So I hope, and I want you to pray for me, because it's always hard to get up and say stuff like that, because people get upset. But it's even harder for me to hear it, because I can't pretend I don't know. And that's when I walked in, he says, how are you? I said, oh, it's one of those days where I wish I didn't know. But I want to thank you again because there is a brighter hope. I firmly believe that you and I can make decisions, we can inform ourselves, we can be culturally competent, but we're just like those ever-ready batteries. We just keep going on and on, and the thing about oral tradition is you'll tell one person who'll tell another person who'll tell another person. And we'll make that change. We'll make that change inside of ourselves. We'll get ourselves culturally competent in the language. We'll get ourselves competent in knowledge. We'll build our capacity to start forcing the government. We know you're going to international trade agreements. This is what you're going to say when you're over there. We're going to start standing up for each other because we know, and we say it inside the union, the injury of one is the injury of all. The Canadians have always said that historically. We've left that someplace. We started fighting for that pieces of the pie and we forget that's the only pie that's ever going to exist in Canada. It is called our country. We need to look after it, but we need to be the Canadians that God created us to be, and that's the principle of sharing. Because we know that everything that came here, there's more. We just need to take care of it so it can reproduce itself, because the earth is a living entity. And we need to give her space to do that. We don't need to take more. And right now my finances are so bad, this is how I'm learning it, is that I'm finding out I've lived a pretty strong 4 or 5 years of wants, and I'm now back to the basics of needs and really payday to payday, right? And I'm just as happy. So I don't know how I fell into that and why I thought I was better, and it was just a head game. So how much of are we living wants when we really need to get back to our basic needs and the basic fundamental who we are as Canadians and get back to our right to freedom and democracy and have our country be run by a representative government that will stand in solidarity with us. That's the joke. Yeah, sure.
comments carried many, many different messages that I think, you know, speak to the holistic nature of the health, of the need for health, and certainly, you know, we're not going to get any further down that road until we recognize that the holistic nature, and you know, that's so true to so much.